the ones that are quiet and hide. Here's to the ones that just keep it inside.
wasn't ready to be no millionaire. I was ill-prepared, I was prepared to be ill, though the skill was there. In the beginning, it wasn't about the ends, it was about busting raps and standing for something. Fucking acronym, cut the fucking act like you're happy. I'm fucking back again with another anthem. Why stop when it doesn't have to end? It ain't over till I say it's over. Enough when I say enough. Throw me to the wolves and close the gate up. I'm afraid of what'll happen to them wolves when the thought of being thrown into an alligator pit. I salivated it, raiders up, hands up like it's 12 noon. Nah, homie, holding bitches straight up. Wave them to your dislocator, rotator cuff. Came up rough, came to ruffle feathers. Nah, egos, I ain't deflating. My last chance to make this whole stadium in rust. Close to my goals, I can almost pole vault over the goalpost. And if I don't got enough in the tank, maybe I can just siphon enough to fill up this last can. Man, will I survive in this climate or what? They said I was washed up and got a bloodbath. I'm not a rapper, I'm an adapter. I can adjust, plus I can just walk up to a mic and just bust. So floor's open if you'd like to discuss. Top five in this motherfucker, and if I don't make the cut, what, like I give a fuck? I'ma light this bitch off like I'm driving a truck through the side of a pump. 0 to 60, hopping and gunning like G-Unit without the hyphen. I'm hyping them up. And if there should ever come a time where my life's in a rut, and I look like I might just give up, it might have been stuck. Me for bowing out, I ain't taking a bow. I'm stabbing myself with a fucking knife in the gut while I'm wiping my butt. Cause I just shit it on the mic and I like getting cut. I get excited at the sight of my blood. You're in a fight with a nut. Cause I'ma fight till I die, I win. Biting the dust, it'll just make me angrier. Wait, let me remind you of what got me this far. Picture me quitting, I draw a circle around it and put a line to it, smut. It's survival or what? It's what you eat, sleep, piss, and shit. Live, breathe, your whole existence just consists of this. Refuse to quit, fuse is lit, can't defuse the wick. I don't do this music shit, I lose my shit. Ain't got shit to lose, it's the moment of truth. It's all I know how to do. As soon as I get thrown in the booth, I spit. But my respect is overdue, I'm showing you the flow. No one do, cause I don't know no diploma for school. I quit, so there's nothing for me to fall back on. I know no other trade, so you better trade your fucking mics in for some toolboxes. Cause you never take my pride from me, it'll have to be pride from me. So pull out your pliers and your screwdrivers. But I want you to doubt me, I want you to believe. Cause this is something that I must use to succeed. And if you don't like me, then fuck you. Self-esteem must be fucking shooting through the roof. Cause trust me, my skin is too thick and bulletproof to touch me. I can see why the fuck I disgust you. I must be allergic to failure, cause every time I come close to it, I just sneeze. But I just go 1, 2, then up, cheese.
We'll be right back. Canva, it's not just a whiteboard, but a playground.
It was February 1990. Nintendo of America was about to release one of their biggest games of all time, Super Mario Bros. 3. And the hype was real. Super Mario Bros. 3 came out a year and a half earlier in Japan, and even in a time before internet, North American gamers knew all about it. Throughout 1989, magazines printed previews and teasers. A major Hollywood movie showed off the game. Some stores even sold import or bootleg versions of the game. But Super Mario Bros. 3 was more than just another game in the series. It proved that Nintendo and Super Mario Bros. Were not a fad. And even with competition from other companies, Nintendo was still the king of video games. This is the story of how one game captured the hearts and minds of an entire generation of players. This is the story of Super Mario Bros. 3. By the summer of 1986, Mario Fever had officially hit Japan. Nintendo's Super Mario Bros. For the Famicom was a smash hit, selling more than 3 million copies. The country's best-selling book was Super Mario Bros. The Complete Strategy Guide, which contained tips and tricks on how to beat the game. The Mario Brothers theme song was given lyrics and released as a single, Go Go Mario. Super Mario Brothers even shifted Japan's public perception on video games.
Before Super Mario Brothers came out, even the parliament had taken up the issue of the influence of video games on children, and newspaper articles were mostly negative. But Mario's bright atmosphere cleared away that prejudice against the Famicom. Hiroshi Imanishi, Nintendo.
The game caused a sales explosion for the Famicom system. By June of 1986, Nintendo had sold more than 6.5 million units. One out of every five households in Japan had a Famicom. And with Super Mario Bros.' enormous success, a sequel was never in doubt. Super Mario Bros. 2 was released on June 3, 1986, less than a year after the original game's debut. Nintendo released the game on the Famicom Disk System, a new add-on for the Famicom that would play games using proprietary disks. They were cheaper to make than standard cartridges, and could hold more data. Nintendo hoped that all their future big releases would be dedicated to the disk system. A sequel to the most popular Famicom game would help drive sales. Super Mario Bros. 2 would become the best-selling game on the disk system, selling more than 2 million units. But players were hungry for more. The game felt more like an expansion pack than a true sequel. Visually, Super Mario Bros. And Super Mario Bros. 2 were almost identical. It was also an extremely difficult game, which was a turnoff for new players. Nintendo even advertised it as such, slapping a For Super Players label on the game's packaging. And players weren't the only ones who wanted a true sequel. Research and Development 4, the team behind the first two Super Mario Bros. Games, were ready to provide the Famicom with the ultimate Mario game. So Nintendo got to work. A team of over 10 people at R&D 4 would be responsible for making Super Mario Bros. 3. Their leader was Shigeru Miyamoto. If Mario was Nintendo's Mickey Mouse, Shigeru Miyamoto was Nintendo's Walt Disney. He created Mario back in 1981, and since then had seen his character become the face of the company. Miyamoto took a step back during the development of Super Mario Bros. 2. He had recently become a father and was involved in too many projects. But now he was ready to throw himself completely into a sequel. He would oversee almost every aspect of the creation of Super Mario Bros. 3. Miyamoto's right-hand man, Takashi Tezuka, was named the game's director. Tezuka joined Nintendo 2 years earlier at the age of 24, and was instrumental in the design and development of Super Mario Bros. And The Legend of Zelda. Following that, Tezuka was given his first director job on Super Mario Bros. 2. His work on that game, while facing a tight deadline, proved he was more than capable of doing the job. But Super Mario Bros. 3 would prove to be a challenge. Toshihiko Nakago was the main programmer. He began his career at Nintendo in 1983 by porting arcade